Imagine a creature that can strike out of the blue, see in the dark, and kill without sound. The ghostly owl. Sometimes heard, yet rarely seen. Wise, magical, the companion of witches and wizards. We have five kinds of owl haunting our countryside. Some common, some rare, all highly secretive. This is the story of one remarkable place in a corner of northeast England where all five owls live together. They're here because of another more endangered breed, a creature whose way of life is the key to the owl's survival. Five Owl Farm lies in a land steeped in history. The owls living here must have witnessed many of the events that shaped our kingdom. Adapting to the changes, they have each exploited the different habitats created by human activity over time. First farmers carved fields from forests as they cleared the land and created their farmsteads. A thousand years later, the Roman invasion brought agriculture on a scale never seen before as the legions pushed north to York. Then Viking raids pushed farmers off their lands and huge areas reverted to scrub before being resettled. And finally, the strife-torn millennium that saw the Norman conquest, War of the Roses, and the Civil War, and created the countryside that is here today. Throughout all this time, owls thrived here. But then there were only four kinds. The fifth had a helping hand to arrive. In the early 1820s, not far from Five Owl Farm, Charles Waterton, pioneering naturalist and explorer, created the world's first nature reserve and introduced a bird from the continent, the little owl. Other releases, both here and across the country, successfully added a new character to the story. And now we are five. The little owl's spread was dramatic, perhaps because it already had an ally in Britain, the mole. This master mini excavator creates a network of tunnels to catch its staple diet of earthworms. During the digging, lots of worms get thrown out with the spoil. It's an easy meal for a bird that specializes in such small prey, and the owl thrived. So by the late 19th century, all five owls were well established here. But a revolution was about to begin. For centuries, the pace of life on the land was dictated by the speed of the horse. In the last 50 years, machinery altered everything. Even within living memory, the speed of change has transformed much of our farmland beyond recognition. So how did the owls cope with the change? The Vale of York is an industrial region known for its coal fields and heavy industry. Yet between still lies a rich patchwork of meadow and arable land, as anybody travelling the main East Coast rail line can see. When the house at Five Owl Farm was built in late Georgian times, 200 acres was considered a good-sized farm. Today, it's small. Andrew Ritchie is the third generation to farm here, and it's still a traditional mixed farm with animals and crops, just as it was in his grandfather's time. Milking early morning and every evening still rules the daily rhythm of the farm. Today, three generations of families still help work the farm, but they could be among the last of their kind. For over 2,000 years, farming families have lived off this low-lying land. So what's the secret that makes this place so remarkable that five different isles can all live here together? This is reclaimed marshland, so wet it can only be worked for half the year. A network of drainage ditches with rough grassy banks is ideal for the short-eared owl to hunt voles. This ancient oak near the farmyard cast its shade here long before the house was built. And it's probably offered little owls a home since they were first released. Nearby scattered woods and copses are the remnants of the once great Sherwood Forest. And tall hedgerow trees allow long-eared owls to thrive, just as they have since Robin Hood's time. Deep in the woods, large holes provide safe nesting sites for the tawny owl, the most widespread and adaptable of all owls. Yet the rarest owl often chooses to nest nearest to people. The barn owl has probably seen the comings and goings of more humans than any other. Here, over hundreds of years, the lives of owls have become entwined as much with the daily activity of the farm as the passing of the seasons. Having survived all these years, they now face their greatest challenge. How much longer can they survive here? Winter is slow to release its icy grip from the wolds and dales of Yorkshire. A northeast wind sees the return of biting cold. February can be the toughest time of all. Food is scarce, shelter at a premium, for farmers and owls. A tree covered in evergreen ivy is the tawny's favourite retreat. Within the farm, protected from the worst of the weather, spring doesn't seem so far away. Already the first hand-reared lambs of the year are demanding Sarah's attention. The benefit of the barn owl's long alliance with farmers pays dividends in deep winter when rodents are attracted into buildings to find food. Hunting success depends on silent flight, and that means keeping soft feathers dry. The farmer is repaid for leaving access into his old buildings, It's not surprising that owls are called cats with wings. Eyes that can pierce near darkness and hearing of uncanny power make the owl a formidable predator. Snow doesn't linger in this low-lying vale. Another reason why the owls are all here. A new life is again stirring on the farm. Snowdrops are among the earliest flowers to bloom. It's still cold outside with a bitter wind, yet longer days have woken a primeval force. In the old oak tree, the little owls have restaked their claim to their nest site. The urge to prepare for the coming season is strong. Farmers must make the most of good weather. Preparing the ground and drilling seed is today a task that would have taken Andrew's grandfather several days. Now it can be finished in hours. Yet despite the efficiency, it still leaves some spilt grain for wood mice to scavenge. More food for owls. But daylight is not the time for tawny owls. They're not tolerated by other birds. So for now, the best tactic is to lie low from the mob. Dusk. Now the tables are turned and the tawny can hunt unhindered. The season is gathering pace. It's not long before the first crops appear. So what makes this farm so special that five owls can all thrive here? The land provides one answer. During the past 5 months, the surrounding fields have been left untouched, too wet for cattle to graze, yet creating the rough tussocky grassland that's ideal winter hunting ground for all five owls. The cattle, sheltered throughout winter, are now keen to get at the fresh growing grass. It's an important event in the farming calendar. Rare fritillary flowers only grow in ancient, undisturbed meadows like these. But there's a bigger surprise in the woods today. It's March, and the tawny owl already has a family. They're barely a week old, and always the first owlets to hatch on the farm. Breeding so early gives them a head start on the other owls, before spring really gets underway. The short-eared owl has another tactic to avoid competition. It does not spend the entire year on the farm. By the end of April, they're ready to leave. Heading for the uplands of Wuthering Heights, they become moorland birds for the short summer months. Here they will find a plentiful supply of voles amongst the heather and rough grass. Back on the farm, the nearby churchyard is now haunted by the barn owl. With less farm buildings available for nesting, the church tower provides an ideal site. It's a busy time for the farmer as well as us, and a downturn in the weather could spell disaster for both. In nature, like farming, being early is a risk. But with luck and some adaptability, it can give you the edge on the competition. These tawny owlets are now just 3 weeks old, and their appetites are growing day by day. The tawny is our most common and successful owl, partly because they'll eat almost anything from beetles to small birds. Their young are already showing signs of increasing independence. While the tawny's hoot is often heard, they're rarely seen. As the most nocturnal of all owls, that's not surprising. But this is. It's the first time a tawny owl has ever been caught fishing. Many freshwater fish are active after dark. This may be a meal the adaptable tawny often exploits. In the old oak tree, the little owls also now have a brood. They're tiny. Just a few days old, not much bigger than your thumb. At this age, they're very susceptible to cold, and their mother must keep close until the weather warms. Bluebells signal the start of summer, longer days and warmer nights. The twilight zone, a time when the supernatural powers of owls are at their best. A long-eared owl quarters a meadow for prey, eyes and ears tuned to the slightest movement or sound. His mate has commandeered an old crow's nest, high in a thorn tree. Here, exposed to the weather, she must sit tight to protect her young and just wait for her partner to return with food. Long-eared owls specialize in hunting small mammals and birds. They're no threat to the farmers living, in fact, more a friend, unlike some other birds. But their habit of nesting in old crow's nests can put them in mortal danger from the farmer's gun. Shooting crows to safeguard lambs is a regular activity on most farms. Crows are wary birds, so one of the most effective ways of controlling their numbers is to destroy their nest. Luckily for the long-eared family, farmers in the Vale make sure that any crow's nest is owl-free. It's early May, and the tawny owl nest is surprisingly quiet. Only the youngest member of the family remains. The rest are exploring the world outside. Branch hopping is an essential prelude to flying. So is the ability to climb if you fall out of your tree. And young tawny owls are experts at both. The parents can only watch as their offspring make their first leap for independence. The ground is not a safe place for a young tawny owl. While woodland offers plenty of cover from possible predators, out in the open field, this owlet is taking a real risk. There are so many hazards out here for a little bird with no experience. Young foxes are trainee opportunists. It's all so new, bewildering to a young owl venturing into a big, wide world. The first grass cut of the year creates a killing field. A kestrel is quickly on the scene. Now exposed, voles and mice are the focus of all the attention. But while a kestrel is unlikely to attack a young owl, there are still many perils out here. The owlet is safe for the moment. From all around the farm, a freshly cut field attracts more and more predators. The barn owl is soon on the scene. For a vole caught in the open, the best tactic is to keep still. But owls don't miss much. Even on a traditional farm using modern machinery, vast quantities of grass can be cut and baled for animal feed at a spellbinding rate. Nothing, it seems, can stop its progress. Yet many farmers still find time to move young creatures out of harm's way. This time the owlet was lucky, but the sad fact is that they'll be fortunate if more than one of the tawny brood survive this year. On more modern intensive farms, owls can fare much worse than here. Where farming relies on the chemical control of weeds and pests, it also deprives owls of their prey. Creatures that have thrived for thousands of years are now having a tough time. In some years, not a single young owl will make it. Scavengers always profit from the casualties. The church tower is ominously quiet, but barn owls, like most birds, tend to keep a low profile when breeding, especially when they have young in the nest. They are the last owls to hatch on the farm. The male will now be kept busy bringing in a regular supply of food. Field vole comes high on the menu. It's a big meal for an owl, but they'll still need to catch several a day. A second chick has just emerged. All owls hatch as they were laid, one every 48 hours. So there can be several days' difference between the ages of the young in the same brood. Barn owls can only hunt efficiently in fine weather. Rain and wind hinders their search for prey, so they'll often stockpile enough food to last a day or two. For the first few weeks, their mother will feed them on the smallest bits throughout the day and night. At this tender age, they're still vulnerable to cold. It'll be a few weeks before they develop a sufficient layer of downy feathers and can be left on their own. Crops need a plentiful supply of rain to do well. This year it isn't in short supply. For the long-eared owls nesting in exposed sites, the young must mature fast. They need to. The weather here can be ferocious, straight off the North Sea. Parent birds know the signs well. A rainstorm is on the way. Sudden downpours can take a heavy toll of young birds, so it is just as well that their mother's feathers can create a waterproof cloak to protect her offspring. The sun soon dries rain-soaked feathers. Some kinds of owl seem to resist water better than others. Young tawnies appear to be among the most weatherproof owls. While barn owls are the least. Growing up can be a boring business. Barn owls take a long time to mature. Their young spend up to 10 weeks in the nest, twice as long as the tawny owl chicks. It's good to have a varied diet. This time it's a shrew. Barn owls are the only ones that eat shrews, reducing competition with the other owls. It's early summer. The nights are getting shorter. The little owl family is growing, getting hungrier by the day. No longer content with waiting inside the oak tree, from now on they will doorstep their parents for a meal. Warm, wet nights are perfect for finding a good supply of earthworms. They're everywhere, which is just as well. The oak tree brood has close competition from a rival clan of little owls in the farmyard, the hole-in-the-wall gang. All owls are wary of each other. Conflict is uncommon. But being the smallest, it pays to be careful. Where there is plenty of prey, little owls can nest surprisingly close to each other. The rival brood has nested in an old wall close to the farmhouse. Lighting around the farmyard attracts many moths and other insects, all good fodder for the little owl. Of all five owls, the little owl is the most adventurous. Over the last century and a half, they've colonised nearly all the English lowlands and still seem to be doing well. In contrast, the barn owl has become increasingly rare over the last 50 years. But in this family, with just two offspring and a plentiful supply of food, both stand a good chance of survival. Growing well, they're now able to swallow their food whole and developing the feathered face that is the mark of an owl. Mid-winter sees the start of more settled weather, good for owls and crops alike. The long-eared family is now almost full grown. It won't be long before they're off hunting for themselves. In time, they too will find a mate and raise their own broods on the farm, just as generations of owls have done before them. It's July, and the harvest has begun. And once a good part of the work is done, it's showtime. While Andrew and Sarah take a well-earned break, all seems quiet on the farm, but there is plenty of illicit activity in the yard. Rats are quick to exploit spilt grain. At Five Owl Farm, when the farmer is away, it's the owls that play. All youngsters are inquisitive, and little owls are among the most curious. The only way to learn if a hole might be a potential nest is to go exploring. It's the end of another long day. Farming is not so much a job, more a way of life. And delivering new life to the farm is all in a day's work. This calf is the last of the season. The farming year may be drawing to a close, but nature never sleeps. As summer ends, the barn owls in the belfry are now all but full grown, and it won't be long before they leave the safety of their lofty home. It's been another good year for the owls of Five Owl Farm. All have successfully reared their broods. Fortunately for owls, change here has been slow for over 200 years. This farm has survived, passing farming traditions from parents to children. Traditions that have ensured the survival of our owls. Autumn is a time of plenty. The fruits of summer now ready for picking. And all that young owls have to do is learn some of the tricks of the trade. Wood mice collect larders of food ready for winter. This one is using an old blackbird's nest. But owls see and hear everything. The short-eared owls have returned to the farm after a successful summer on the moors, and now we are five again. Rearing half a dozen youngsters in one season, it's not hard to see how the little owls managed to colonise most of England. But of all the owls, the long-eared are the ones most likely to remain together outside the breeding season. Some communal roosts may contain more than one family. Breeding at different times, using different nest sites, feeding on a wide variety of prey to reduce competition, these five owls have found a way to succeed in this special place. Now another chapter in the story of our owls is being written. A new invader from the land of the Vikings has recently arrived in Britain. The eagle owl has landed. 10 times the size of our largest owl, this is the most spectacular owl to reach our shores. and now we are six. Over thousands of years, owls have cast their spell over people. It's hard to imagine a countryside without them. Yet their greatest challenge is still to come in this fast-changing world. How many more years will the old oak tree survive here with its surrounding rich, wet meadows, hedgerows and woods? The railway that passes through this farm may soon be upgraded to a much wider, faster, busier main line. And what of the vital ingredient that keeps the owl's magic alive? Apart from the barn owl, most of our owls are not particularly rare. Yet where would they all be without their age-old alliance with the most endangered breed, the traditional farmer? Without them, the owls could all just vanish.